Well, how could you not be interested in Nixon? He was the most fascinating character, political character of my lifetime. What happened was I was already writing about his administration and so on. I was relatively new at the New Yorker, though, and I went to see William Shawn, the justly legendary editor, around Labor Day, right after Labor Day in 73, on Labor Day. And he said to me, I won't try to, he had a very soft voice, a very gentle way of speaking, and he asked me what I was interested in writing about. And I said, well, Mr. Shawn, I think within a year we are likely to change vice presidents. Remember, Spiro Agnew was under investigation then, and he was indicted after that, and presidents. This was a pretty far-out thought, but until that lady from Delaware who ran for the Senate used the same line, I used to say, I'm not such a great reporter, I'm a witch. I just smelled it, I just sensed it, I go a lot by instinct. And so he was very interested in that. And being him, he landed on a really interesting point. He said, you know, we don't know how to change vice presidents. We don't have any way, any tradition, any method. So even that would be interesting. And you think it might get to Nixon? Yes, I said, I think it really might. There's just enough there that is very troubling. So we agreed that I would keep a journal, not a diary, a journal, which meant I would go to events. It wasn't just my interior thoughts. I would go to an event, I would cover something, or I would write about something that happened and comment on it. So it was commentary and reporting. It turned out to be a dream assignment. But when we started, we had no idea where it was going, really. And I can still remember the Saturday that the president said he wanted to fire the special counsel, independent counsel, Archibald Cox. And Mr. Shawn called me up and said, don't you think this might be it? And I said, yes, I think this might be it. He said, you better keep going. And so we followed it to the end. So it was the atmosphere. And it was a strange atmosphere. It's hard to describe. It was an atmosphere of semi-hilarity, nervous laughter, and fear. Because we never knew what was going to come next. I mean, you might be eating your lunch and somebody will call you up. Remember, we had no cable then, and we had no Twitter. Thank heavens. I mean, I love them now, but it would have been just a mess to try to keep it straight then. So we traveled by morning paper, occasional radio bulletin, but that wasn't very much a presence. And the evening papers, there were afternoon papers then, the Washington Star, and the nightly news. That was it. And so other than that, it was rumor and, you know, calling each other up saying, have you heard? You won't believe what we heard now. So in the journal that comes out is this book, Washington Journal. I keep a real-time journal, and you can see that, you know, you might be peacefully having lunch in Lafayette Square Park, and bang, somebody comes along and says, have you heard the tapes are missing? Or the 18 and a half minutes have been erased. And you just didn't know what was going to come where. The fear was, because the Nixon White House didn't observe boundaries, which was its ultimate downfall. What's ultimate downfall was Nixon, but that's another question. We had every reason to suspect we were being wiretapped. You didn't know, so we kind of joke about it nervously. It's like, well, I wonder if the tapper's there, you know. And strange things would happen. Somebody was parked in a car in front of my house for about a day. And another journalist who lived up the street went down and questioned him, and he sort of said something odd and drove off. You wonder. One Sunday, the newspapers were late, but a friend of mine went out to get the papers, and they weren't there, and she said, they stopped the presses. This wasn't a wild thought. Complicated. He did turn on the president for his own advantage, in order to make a deal. If you're talking about his current book, none of these books really add to the sum of what we know. And Dean, in a couple of places, knocks down a couple of big things that were on tapes because he's got his own tapes that he's saying are important. So I take John Dean with more of a grain of salt than a lot of people do. He sort of created himself as this good angel of the whole thing. I think the picture is a little more mixed than that. poor woman. She was very loyal and very faithful to the president and secretary. They were very big on pinning things on other people. So the 18 and a half minutes were found to be missing from a very important tape. And so they tried to pin it on Rose. She was called Rose, and she was close to the Nixon family. And so she took the fall, or she tried to. The idea was that she had somehow mistakenly erased it because she was answering the phone and her foot was on the pedal, and she tried to act it out in court, but she couldn't do it. It was physically impossible. So she took the fall. She tried to take the fall for him, so she was faithful. Kay Graham was a very brave woman. She was new to being the publisher of the Post. She'd been the housewife with four children. Her husband died, and she took it over. And the Nixon people meant business. When Pat Buchanan, he came on a television program that I did, an interview program, and he talked about that they would go for ideological antitrust against the networks. And he said to me ahead of time, I'm going to the network brass jumping out of their windows. I mean, cute. And so there was that atmosphere of intimidation. They had television stations, the Graham family did. The Washington Post Company did. And so those were sort of threatened a little bit. So this was not easy to just blithely go ahead. And then, of course, they had to be right. So I think she and Ben Bradley both. Ben insisted. He backed Woodward and Bernstein, but he insisted that they really have it down cold, whatever they were going to write. And Kay Graham backed them all the way. Also, she went ahead and published the Pentagon Papers when there had been an embargo against it by the government or something like that, and she and the Times both went ahead and published them. That was a very gutsy call because you're vulnerable if you've got the television stations or if you're running the newspaper. Pat Nixon, it's interesting. The theory was that they had a sort of not much of a marriage. We know they slept in separate rooms. She didn't say much. She always kind of looked unhappy. She hated politics. But the evidence now is they were a lot closer than we knew. And I think they got a lot closer too after Nixon left office. And she was so glad that they were out of politics. And she was very supportive. And I don't know if you recall, it was on television, Nixon sobbing and sobbing at her funeral. And so since come out, love letters he had written her. Now when he was in the White House, he would write to her memo and say, to the First Lady from the President, the green curtains have to go, or something like that. I have a certain amount of empathy for the man. He was trapped in his own personality. And by that I mean, he had grown up resentful. His family was not at all well off. His father was a bit of a bully and hit his sons, I gather. His mother was, he kept saying she was a saint, but she was off away a lot with the two brothers who had tuberculosis. And so she really paid attention to them. And according to even Nixon, it was very hard to get praise out of her. And he was accomplishing a lot even before he became president. I think she finally said she was proud of him when he became president. So he was always thinking, he was a sort of scrawny kid and not at all athletic. He was bookish. And this was not the thing in Whittier, California. So he was a loner. And he built up a lot of resentments against people who were better off than they were, who didn't appreciate his fine mind, who he was sure looked down on him. And his problem was, he associated opposition, political opponents or people who criticized him, he decided they were enemies. So he came into the White House with this mentality. And there's a wonderful soliloquy that he said when he got out to San Clemente. In my book, I add on a whole section since the New Yorker pieces about what happened after he left office, which is extremely interesting. But he set out in San Clemente to an aide, you do this, you want to fight back at people, you want to get them, and it's a piece of cake. And so it becomes easy, it becomes the natural thing to do. But maybe this time I went too far. And that was what led to all of this. The plumbers, espionage on a political opponent, breaking in, whether he knew about this or that doesn't matter. He created the atmosphere in which these things all happened. The aides were doing what they thought he wanted done. In some cases, he did know. He did instruct them, it's on tape, to break into the Brookings institution and get a file and blow it up. And at least that time, an aide had the sense to kill that plan. But usually, they carried out what he said. He drank a lot. And he might call somebody at 3 in the morning and say, I want the whole 7th floor of the State Department fired. And then they would have to decide, you know, what are you going to do about this? And which orders do they follow and which do they not? Now, the people who he was talking to, I don't think you and I would think had the most wonderful judgment in the world. So it was a very dangerous mix to bring into there. He was bitter, he was angry, and he kept on the same mode of whatever works, and they're going to try to get me, and my enemies will never let go, and I have to be sure that I'm reelected. So I'm going to take all these actions to make sure that I am. Watergate, you haven't asked me yet, but I'll answer it anyway. It was really two things. And part of it was what I was just talking about, which was the party in power in the White House manipulating, interfering with the nominating process of the opposition party. I mean, I said in the book, this way lies fascism. Bully boys, people going into campaign events of Democrats and messing them up, sending in pieces, sending in mice. You know, Donald Segretti, they call him the guy of dirty tricks and how funny it was. It wasn't funny. It's not funny to do these things. Now, they wanted to run against McGovern. They thought he'd be the weakest. Did they bring that about? I don't know. You can't prove it. But it was the outcome that they wanted. So they had Ted Kennedy tail. They did stuff about Muskie. And they ended up with the candidate they wanted. It was also a constitutional crisis of very alarming proportions. Was a president accountable to the Congress, to the courts? He was trying to defy a Supreme Court order to turn over the tapes. It was frightening. Very complicated man. He had a very complicated relationship with Nixon. He would flatter Nixon. Nixon needed a lot of flattery. Said he didn't, but he did. And then Henry Kissinger would go to the Georgetown cocktail parties. They weren't mythical then, they were real, much more than now. Or his buddies up in Cambridge, he'd come down from Harvard, and badmouth Nixon. Now Nixon knew this. Nixon was no fool. He pulled one on Kissinger one time. Kissinger made a point of asking, he designed himself, I think, to sort of defray attacks on him for Vietnam and some of their policies, because they kept that war going 4 or 5 years longer than it needed to be done. The deal they got in the end with the North Vietnamese isn't very different from the one they were offered when Nixon came in. So the way Kissinger sort of defrayed all that was he made himself into this swinger. I'm a secret swinger. And he dated a lot of beautiful women, Jill St. John, and went on like this. And he would ask the White House social secretary to seat him at state dinners next to the most beautiful woman in the room. So Nixon found out about that, and he put a stop to it. And that was the thing he pulled on Henry. So they had a sort of relationship of mutual need. They worked together on some very important things, the opening to China, détente with the Soviet Union. These were major achievements, but they also had a mutual distrust. Also, Nixon always referred to Kissinger as my Jew, and Kissinger didn't like that very much. I think I did. The idea was catch it while it's happening. And the book first came out in 1975, but my mentor at the time, John Gardner, great man, who, and I had come back from New York, back to the conversation with William Shawn. And I told him about it. We were having lunch and he said, Elizabeth, write it so that 40 years, he said 40 years from now, people will say, oh, so that's what it was like. You can't go back and recapture this period. And in some ways it's more vivid now than it was then. And as I reread it for putting it, publishing it again, I was stunned by many things. Oh my God, I forgot that. And the whole piling on one thing after another, the suddenness of events, the sort of wildness of some of these things. Some of them were very funny, and some was, you know, very scary, or both at the same time. And then I added on, just this year, a whole new section, 10,000 word section, of Nixon, after he left office, decided, he'd always gotten back up from crises. He said, a man is never defeated when he's beaten, he's defeated when he quits. And Nixon, again, he was not going to give up. So he decided he was going to make himself a respected figure again, a foreign policy guru, because everybody wants to hear about foreign policy, they don't really want to hear about education or things like that. And it was his strong suit. So he had this plan. He and his aides concocted this, always had to be a secret plan, called the Wizard Project. And the Wizard Project was how Nixon would work his way back up to respectability. It's a long story, and some of it's very funny, some of it's very interesting. By his standards, he won. He had a funeral he'd be so proud of. Five presidents were there, existing, extant president, four former presidents. His library, he had four presidents, but at the funeral, he had five. This was what he wanted, and Statesman and Kissinger was there crying and, you know, choking and this sort of thing. This is what he wanted, and he, by various means, he got it. I don't know that I can say one. I suppose the most important one is, look at these candidates very carefully. And look at who they have around them. Learn as much as you can before they're in there. I think that's the most important thing, but beyond that, we learned a lot about it. A lot of things were done to fix plug holes in the corruption. There was a lot of corruption. That wasn't the heart of it, though. The heart of it was the constitutional crisis and the coup, really, to attempted coup on the other party. So, you know, campaign finance reform started after that. Now it keeps getting reversed and mucked up by the Supreme Court. There is a majority that's against it. But other things happened to Congress. There were more openness rules. There were inspectors general were founded to monitor what was going on in departments. So it did have a substantive effect as well as an atmospheric one. Now, Mr. Gardner, the same one, said to me, and it's in the book, but I don't name him. He said, you know, the next time they'll be very clean cut. I mean, these people were clean cut, but they'll look like businessmen. You know, people will, if they try anything like this again, I don't think anybody, they don't dare, because look at what happened to Nixon.